We begin with our call to worship. When you feel alone, don't despair.
Christ is with us.
When your hope falters, open your ears.
God is still speaking words of comfort and love.
When your spirit tires, open your hearts.
The Spirit is here to guide us.
Here, in this time of worship, connect, rejoice, and be at peace. We pray. Fellow traveler, you meet us as we walk the roads of life and reveal to us mighty things. You call us to change our lives and to depend on you. You teach us the greatest, deepest mysteries and reveal the truth of your promised grace. Open our ears to hear your words and open our hearts to burn with your truth, that mutual love may burst forth among all people here on earth. Amen. Our opening hymn is two verses of the hymn, Alleluia, Jesus is Risen. We continue with the prayer of confession. Merciful God, you walk with us.
Even when we fail to see.
You call to us.
Even when we fail to hear.
You listen for our petitions.
Even when we fail to speak.
You whisper words of love.
Even when we respond with indifference.
You call us to repentance.
Even when we don't see the need.
Forgive us, Holy One.
Heal our hardness of heart, that we may turn to you anew.
Open our minds to your Spirit.
That we may hear your words.
Refresh our souls.
That we may speak of your love.
In the Redeemer's name we pray.
Amen.
In the name of the risen Christ, we are forgiven and free. In the power of God's enduring word, we are given new birth and offered a community of resurrection and hope. Our hymn of praise is two verses from We Praise You, O God. Thank you. Please join me in the prayer of the day. Loving God, companion on the way, you walk behind, beside, beyond. You catch us unawares. Break through the disillusionment and despair clouding our vision, that with wide-eyed wonder we may find our way and journey on as messengers of your good news. Amen. We hear from scriptures.
A reading from Psalm 116, verses 1 to 4 and 12 to 19. I love the Lord because he hears my requests for mercy. I'll call out to him as long as I live because he listens closely to me. Death's ropes bound me. The distress of the grave found me. I came face to face with trouble and grief. So I called on the Lord's name. Lord, please save me. What can I give back to the Lord for all the good things he has done for me? I'll lift up the cup of salvation. I'll call on the Lord's name. I'll keep the promises I made to the Lord in the presence of all God's people. The death of the Lord's faithful is a costly loss in his eyes. Oh yes, Lord, I am definitely your servant. I am your servant and the son of your female servant. You've freed me from my chains. So I'll offer a sacrifice of thanksgiving to you, and I'll call on the Lord's name. I'll keep the promises I made to the Lord in the presence of all God's people in the courtyards of the Lord's house, which is the center of Jerusalem. Praise the Lord.
Inspire our understanding, Spirit of God. We will offer the sacrifice of thanksgiving to God by singing our next hymn, three verses of hymn number 879, For the Beauty of the Earth. The Holy Gospel for this, the third Sunday of Easter, is from the Gospel of Luke, the 24th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. On that same day, two disciples were traveling to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking to each other about everything that had happened. While they were discussing these things, Jesus himself arrived and joined them on their journey. They were prevented from recognizing him. He said to them, "What are you talking about as you walk along?" They stopped, their faces downcast. The one named Cleopas replied, "Are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who is unaware of the things that have taken place there over the last few days?" He said to them, "What things?" They said to him, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth. Because of his powerful deeds and words, he was recognized by God and all the people as a prophet. But our chief priests and our leaders handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. We had hoped that he was the one who would redeem Israel. All these things happened 3 days ago, but there's more. Some women from our group have left us stunned. They went to the tomb early this morning and didn't find his body. They came to us saying that they had even seen a vision of angels who told them he is alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found things just as the women said. They didn't see him." And Jesus said to them, "Oh, you foolish people. Your dull minds keep you from believing all that the prophets talked about. Wasn't it necessary for the Christ to suffer these things and then enter into his glory?" Then he interpreted for them the things written about himself in all the scriptures, starting with Moses and going through all the prophets. When they came to Emmaus, he acted as if he was going on ahead, but they urged him, saying, "Stay with us. It's nearly evening, and the day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. After he took his seat at the table with them, he took the bread, blessed, and broke it, and gave it to them. Their eyes were opened. Their eyes were opened and they recognized him. But he disappeared from their sight. They said to each other, "Weren't our hearts on fire when he spoke to us along the road and when he explained the scriptures for us?" They got up right then and returned to Jerusalem. They found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying to each other, "The Lord really has risen. He appeared to Simon." Then the two disciples described what had happened along the road and how Jesus was made known to them as he broke the bread. The Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please pray with me. Jesus, our guide, you explained the scriptures and revealed yourself to the disciples at Emmaus. Now, by your Spirit, enlighten our minds to understand their witness and ignite our hearts to receive you wholly. Amen. How different is today's gospel from the Easter text we heard a few weeks ago? In that text, Jesus meets the women on the road, and they immediately fall at his feet and worship him. In today's gospel reading, two other disciples are met by Jesus on the road, but they don't recognize him. Even after he walks with them for a while, explaining the meaning of recent events using the scriptures, they still don't recognize him. To them, he is an unknown companion on the road. They are interested enough in what this unknown companion has been saying that they invite him into their house for a meal and to stay the night. It is then, finally, when the unknown one breaks the bread, that the disciples recognize who they have been traveling with. Even though it is evening, these same two disciples right away head back to Jerusalem, a distance of about 12 kilometers, to tell the others the good news of this mysterious encounter with their Lord. What are we to make of this story? Why does the gospel writer Luke include it in his account of Easter Day? Part of the answer to those questions has to do with worship. Luke is writing his gospel many years after Jesus' time on earth, and most, if not all, of his audience have never encountered Jesus in the flesh. So how could they meet Jesus? Or a better question, how could they expect Jesus to meet them? Luke's answer is that those who seek to follow Jesus will meet him in the worship of the Christian church. As part of my doctoral program at the Institute for Worship Studies, I was reminded of the importance of the historic fourfold order of worship, which is gathering, word, table, sending. Since the earliest years of the church's existence, this pattern has been used by Christians as the basis of worship. Dr. Constance Cherry, who was one of the teachers in my most recent class at IWS, explains that it is helpful to view the four parts of worship as a progression. Worship, she says, is a journey that into God's presence, that is gathering, of hearing from God, that is word, that celebrates Christ, that is table, and that sends us into the world changed by our encounter with God, thus sending. So gathering, word, table, sending. I'm quoting Dr. Constance Cherry from this book, The Worship Architect, which was one of the texts for our class, and I found it very helpful reading. So now, here in our gospel text for today, we find some disciples on a literal journey. And this journey with Jesus follows the same sequence as the fourfold pattern of Christian worship. So let us look at each of the four parts, beginning with gathering. The two disciples began their journey discouraged from their life experiences of the preceding week. It was a week of emotional roller coasters, from the exhilaration of the triumphal entry of their Lord into his betrayal, trial, murder, and burial. Life in the world had left them confused and in despair. Yet in the middle of this discouraging life, Jesus approached them, entered their world, and engaged them on their journey. He expressed interest in what they had experienced and accompanied them, conversing along the way. So too does Jesus meet us where we're at. Jesus takes interest in our lives. Jesus engages with us in such a way that community is formed. Worship begins when God encounters us, whether we're aware of it or not. Our relationship with God always begins with God. It is God who calls us by name and invites us into relationship. And the Holy Spirit gathers us with others who have encountered Jesus. And in this gathering, we recognize the common journey we share. At this point in time, our gathering is rather strange. We meet through electronic means. Last Sunday, I sat with Beth in our living room where we gathered with all of you during the live-streamed worship service. As I noticed the names of those who joined the live stream and read the comments that people were making throughout the service, I experienced a true sense of community. In a very real way, I experienced being gathered with our church. That experience of being connected with the community of faith was both a surprise and a delight. The second movement, word. Back to the road to Emmaus. After hearing what was distressing them, Jesus addressed the disciples' dilemma. He opened up the scriptures to them. Jesus proclaimed the word of God beginning with Moses and moved through the writings of the prophets, all the scriptures pertaining to the Messiah. Not only did he proclaim the holy scriptures, but he interpreted them as well. Jesus used the Hebrew sacred writings to explain himself. The exposition of the Word of God formed a critical and central part of the journey. This is exactly what I'm attempting to do right now, to explain and expand on the scripture teachings in order to clarify and deepen understanding of God's presence and purpose unfolding in the world. Just as Jesus took the scriptures of the past to make sense of the present circumstances these disciples found themselves in, so too, in the sermons we preach, your pastors are taking the scriptures of the past to help us to see our place and purpose in the kingdom of God. Through the exposition of scriptures, we seek to trace the line of God's mission in the world from the very beginning of time right up to today and into the future. Those who have participated in the Bible studies I've led have often heard me say how it never ceases to amaze me how much there is to uncover in the Bible. Its depth of meaning can never be exhausted. This coming week, we begin a new experiment in Bible study here at Christ Lutheran. We'll be completing our study on the Gospel of Matthew using an online format. While the method may be different, the message remains the same and is just as relevant as ever. Now to the third movement, table. Now the group arrives at Emmaus, and the scene shifts. As a response to their conversation with this remarkable companion, the disciples offered Jesus lodging for the night. They implore him to spend more time with them. In fact, they strongly urge him to stay. This turned out to be the highlight of the journey, a time of intimate communion with the risen Christ himself. Jesus revealed himself to the disciples in the breaking of bread. At table fellowship, their eyes were opened and they recognized him. What a moment. Experiencing the risen Christ in the context of a holy meal was the apex, the pinnacle of their journey. There are many occasions in the Gospels when Jesus is sharing a meal with his disciples or others he has encountered. While the Emmaus story certainly has an overtone of the Last Supper, it also reminds us of Jesus feeding the multitudes or eating with tax collectors and sinners, or turning water into wine at a wedding. In this Emmaus Road story, we are reminded that Jesus enters where he's invited. He doesn't force his way into people's lives, but when they are open to his gracious presence, they find themselves filled with the bread of heaven and quenched with the water of life. In our house, we say a table grace before each meal. It's a common prayer. Perhaps you use the same one in your homes. Come, Lord Jesus, be our guest. Let these gifts to us be blessed. It struck me this week how the beginning of this table grace is like the Emmaus story. In both cases, we are inviting Jesus to be a guest in our home. This little prayer says so much. First, it acknowledges that Jesus meets us where we are. Just as Jesus met with the women on the road that Easter morning so long ago, or as he joined with the two disciples on the road to Emmaus and then in their home, so too does Jesus meet with us where we are, in our homes. While we cannot physically gather as a community of faith, we can be assured that Jesus joins with us wherever we are. Jesus meets us not only in a church building, but in the everyday places we find ourselves, even when we don't recognize the presence of Jesus, like the disciples on the road. Jesus is there to encourage, guide, and comfort us. The second line of that table grace, at least the way I learned it as a child, says, "Let these gifts to us be blessed." We are indeed blessed by the many gifts of God. Gifts of food and drink, of family and friends, a roof over our heads and walls to keep the elements and dangers out. We are blessed with these and many other gifts, so we pause to be grateful and remember God's blessings. Remembering to be grateful is an important part of our spiritual life. Gratitude is a healthy balance to the selfishness and self-centeredness that creeps into our lives all too easily. When Jesus broke the bread in that house in Emmaus, he very possibly used the hamatzai, that is the traditional blessing of the bread said by Jewish people at important meals. It goes like this. Blessed are you, Adonai, our God, sovereign of all, who brings forth bread from the earth. Even Jesus paused to remember with gratitude that all we have is ultimately from God. And now to the final movement of worship, sending. Once the two disciples in Emmaus were enlightened, once they recognized Christ in their midst, their joy was too overwhelming to contain. They experienced a dramatic urgency. They jumped up and ran to tell others that Jesus Christ was alive. They rushed to Jerusalem to tell their sisters and brothers that they had met the risen Lord. Worship is ultimately not for our benefit. Rather, it benefits others. Encountering Jesus in worship should propel us into the world to proclaim the good news through our words and deeds. Worship prepares us for our continued part in God's mission. That mission is always before us, whether in the confines of our homes or out in the community, or even in a distant land. Robert Weber, who founded the Institute for Worship Studies, summarized what biblical worship does this way. He says, "Worship remembers God's work in the past, anticipates God's rule over all creation, and actualizes both past and future in the present, to transform persons, communities, and the world. So to sum up, here's what this Emmaus Road story teaches us in connection with our worship practice. The incarnational presence of Christ is made known in the entire journey of worship. We are approached by his presence, instructed in his presence, fed by his presence, and we depart with his presence. Gathering, word, table, sending. A journey with Jesus together. This story of the Emmaus Road encounter is a promise that Jesus will always meet us where we are, whether in celebration or mourning, whether in victory or in defeat, whether in gladness or sorrow, whether in times of health or sickness or even pandemic. We are on a journey as individuals, as a congregation, and as a society, both nationally and globally. And Jesus is there with us on the journey while we're still on the road to encourage us, accept us, and embolden us. You may not recognize Jesus' presence right now, but I promise you that as you continue to worship with Christ's disciples, you will come to see the risen Lord active in your life and in the lives of those around you. Regardless of what circumstances we find ourselves in, may our prayer always be, "Come, Lord Jesus, be our guest." Our hymn of the day is three verses. I think it's three. Let's see if I got that right. Yes, three verses of the hymn, Day of Arising, number 374. As is the tradition during the Easter season, we will be using the Nicene Creed to express our common faith. And Joshua will lead us in the creed.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
We now have a time for prayers of intercession, and the petitions will end with, "Lord, in your mercy," and the response is, "Hear our prayer." O God, your Son remained with his disciples after his resurrection, teaching them to love all people as neighbors. As his disciples in this age, we offer our prayers on behalf of the world in which we are privileged to live and our neighbors with whom we share it.
Risen One, like those disciples on the road to Emmaus, we struggle to recognize you in the everyday journey of our lives. We seek your wisdom in the midst of the questions we have about the circumstances we find ourselves in, circumstances sometimes beyond our control, but often of our own making. As you opened the Scriptures to the disciples and taught them everything, open our eyes to behold in you in your word, in the beauty of nature, the beauty of another human being. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Merciful God, we entrust to your tender care those who are ill or in pain. We remember this week those who are in hospital, Clarence Bieberdorf, those who are recovering at home, Dennis Langford and Don McDonald, and those whom we name in our hearts. We entrust them to your loving care, knowing that whenever danger threatens, your everlasting arms are there to hold them safe, comfort and heal them, and restore them to health and strength. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Eternal God, we give you thanks for the hope of resurrection and for the promise of eternal life with you. May that promise bring comfort to those who mourn the loss of a loved one. This week, we remember the friends and family of Dale Hari. Surround all who grieve with your compassionate embrace, that they may be strengthened to meet the difficult days ahead, especially as they navigate the challenges of saying goodbye to a loved one during the coronavirus restrictions. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Gracious God, give skill, sympathy, and resilience to all who are caring for the sick, and your wisdom to those searching for a cure. Strengthen them with your Spirit, that through their work many will be restored to health. Thank you that even in these anxious times you are with us. Help us to put our trust in you and keep us safe. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Creator God, We grieve the state of life and loss on the earth, deteriorating faster than ever before. We confess our selfish actions, taking, using what we want, not only what we need. This year, we have seen how swiftly humans can adapt. Give us the eyes to see wisdom in this moment. Give us the courage to change our ways forever, to live responsibly, to advocate boldly, to honor and protect what you have created. With your help, O God, we will change our ways. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Holy One, so often we forget that you invite us to abide with you, to have our lives hidden in you. We thank you that you travel with us at all times, in our joys and our concerns. With that assurance, we gather these prayers together in your name, our risen Lord and Savior. Amen. We pray using the words our Lord taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. At this time in our worship service, we usually have the offering. I'm going to ask Grant if you put up that slide I have for the offering. I first of all would like to thank everyone who has been sending in their offerings, either in the mail or dropping it off at the church or using the e-transfer option. And of course, we are grateful for those who are on pre-authorized remittance or PAR and give to the church that way. We would like to remind you that in this very unprecedented and difficult time, the church is not the only one who is in need of help, that there are many agencies and ministries that also need help in this difficult time. And you will find that on our website, on the announcement sheet, you will find some information about how you can help out agencies like Indigenous Christian Fellowship, North Central Family Center, Regina Food Bank, Canadian Lutheran World Relief, and others. We ask you to pray that God would guide your giving, that we might all be of help to one another. Our closing hymn today is a hymn based on a familiar tune, but the words are unique. Written again, once again, by Carolyn Willett Giffrey, and the hymn is called Emmaus Bound on Easter Day. We'll sing all the verses of this hymn.
Emmaus bound on Easter day to come. They shared their home, you broke the bread. They saw you risen from the dead. That moment's grace helped them to see the gift of God's eternity. In Scripture and at table too, O risen Lord, may we know you, and may your presence give us grace to share God's love in every place.
May Christ's love fill you this day with the living and enduring Word of God. May Christ's love lift you up and guide you, that you may be an agent of transformation in the world. Shalom and Amen.
Be at peace, inspired by the risen Christ to love and serve.
Thanks be to God.